might have liked to evaluate the various phases that a person can traveling on the moon surface. You do have to be rather careful to keep track of where your center of mass is. Sometimes it takes about 2 or 3 phases to make sure that
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Main engine start, 0, and liftoff.
I don't think there's many who have done as much with it as I have. Growing up as a kid in Arkansas, I wanted to be an astronaut, and kind of hit that time period between Apollo and Shuttle, where they weren't doing much with NASA, and just got off into filmmaking, and I've gone a lot of places and done a lot of things that people only dream of. I've been very lucky that way. I've chased tigers in India and polar bears in the Arctic, and flown into volcanoes and dove underwater and trained people for space. I've been extremely lucky. I just can't, tell people, what it's like, because it's amazing. I sometimes wake up in the morning and going, well, do I really work in a coal mine, or am I going to work as a filmmaker? And fortunately, I'm going to work as a filmmaker, because it's not a dream. It's been a reality. It's kind of a fulfillment of a lifelong dream here to be able to work with the astronauts, to be able to involve with the shuttle program, and to be here today with the shuttle and the VAB in the background, and I think that's probably been the highlight of my career. As far as training the astronauts, some of our more important lessons were, number one, get the camera loaded right. So a lot of the mechanical part was really stressed. They picked that up very quickly. When we're shooting IMAX in zero G, you'd think that holding the camera still would be not a big issue. But in fact, because the camera is in zero G, it doesn't weigh anything. So it's really easy for the astronauts to have the camera and move it around even with just one hand, even though it is a 90-pound camera. We have to really make sure that they get their feet in foot loops and get some sort of force loop around so they can hold that camera steady. The aesthetics of filmmaking, how long to run shots, how to frame, what to shoot, was the more difficult part in training the astronauts. And getting their attention, knowing that they had, even though their timeline was so compressed, it's just every second of time on orbit is subscribed before they launch.
When you have something that is inserted into the timeline of the astronauts on orbit, it's got to be important for the agency to do that. And so that's something that the entire agency values is the IMAX movie.
If something goes wrong, something goes off nominal, we want to catch that off nominal, because we're a documentary film. We want to document what happens. So getting them to kind of put aside what they really have to do and film for us, that's the hardest part.
The format and the capability that the IMAX offers to be able to transmit NASA's story to the public in a way we just can't do.
IMAX 3D has been actually credited with the current resurgence in 3D technology.
You got the very large screen format, you've got big sound, and it's in a dark theater, and it can really make a forceful impact on the viewers.
The large screen is actually tailor-made for 3D. It gives you a 3D experience unlike any other 3D experience out there.
The IMAX movies have a way of drawing the public into an area and into an experience in space that they wouldn't normally have.
Even though it is huge, it is a real personal experience because we're able to bring things much further out into the audience. Much larger objects can be brought out into the audience without resorting to the old poke you in the eye tricks.
Theater is designed in such a way that wherever you sit, you're going to get an experience about what's the content on the show.
By projecting on such a huge screen and with our six-track, six-channel sound system, we can just take people places that they would never go. Take them to space, take them to the top of Mount Everest, take them to the Titanic. And I've had astronauts tell me that the launch experience in our space films is better than the real thing because they don't have to worry about dying and the music's better. So having a camera put into the Smithsonian is pretty phenomenal. I'm really excited about IMAX's donation of our space camera to the National Air and Space Museum. It's pretty unique. I don't think there's a whole lot of camera people out there that can say that the camera that they used for 20 years is now on display at the Smithsonian. So it's quite an honor, and I'm really flattered that the Smithsonian wants our system to be there in Washington, D.C. Even though they've not really discontinued manned spaceflight, we've discontinued manned launches in the U.S. We're still launching with the Russians aboard the Soyuz, but we are in the process of commercializing manned spaceflight in the U.S. So eventually, hopefully in the next 2 or 3, 4 years, we will see come out of the private sector a manned launch system that will get us back flying from here at the Cape. And that's really exciting to me because I think then it can open up to maybe more people be involved in manned space flight. Hopefully someday I might get to go. In the future, I just, more IMAX, more productions, more film. Hopefully we'll be making another space film, some more underwater stuff, lots of things out there, some China projects. There's incredible scenery in China that's yet to be explored, I think, visually with a large format. There's mountains in the world I would love to go see, Kamchatka. I just hope to keep going. I can't afford to retire, so I'm going to drop dead with a can of film in my hand, probably.